Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks, TEDxPortHarcourt, for giving me the opportunity to be here with you today. In looking at the theme, where we are, I won't be speaking to the issue of getting it right, because I believe that as a people, on individual level, family, community level, society, organization, corporate, nation, we are at the point where we need to get it right in whatever it is that we choose to do, or in whatever it is that we need to do, we're doing, we need to get it right. And in getting it right, the big thing is always, or the small thing if you wish, for example, why are we here this morning? Why are we doing what we're doing? Why are we created? Why are we on this earth? If we begin to answer these questions of the why for us, then we begin to plan, and when we plan, then we start to get this right. In answering this question myself personally, I always look at what inspires me. And for me, what inspires me has always been people. People are my inspiration in life, and my aspiration is to impact people positively, leave people in a better condition than I met them. Not surprising, because I grew up as part of a very big family. My father had four siblings, and the children of the five siblings all grew up under one roof. So if you ask me how many siblings do I have, I tell you I have over 100, and these are all blood connected. If you care to carry out a DNA test, these are some of my brothers. Every single person in this picture are at least 10 years older than. So it begins to develop a pattern of, for me, what are important, what are the important things that drive me to do what I do. And these are things that we need to have in place to be able to get things right. My nation, I have no any other country. I have never attempted to get access to any other country in terms of nationality. I do not plan to. This is what I have. So it behooves me to work very hard, and all of us that call this Nigeria our home, to get things right in what we do. Women are also important to me, a gender that I belong to, but also a group that needs the leg up to be able to do what we do. However, we can see that women are emerging. Very slowly, in the last century, we've had three women emerge as presidents on our continent. Better than most continents, but we still have a long way to go. We've had a woman, the only woman to be ever considered and nominated to be possible World War President. And when it happened, the world considered her to be the best person for the job. So we can see that we can break the glass ceiling. We need to take our space, because if we don't, then nobody will give us that space. But we also need to work very hard to do that. And this pre-accident of birth, if you wish, I didn't choose the family that I belong to. I didn't choose Nigeria as my nation. I didn't have a choice to be a woman. It was just happened to me. I look at them as my accountability framework. And when I look that I own this, my constituency something, that I know that I have to get whatever it is that I'm doing right. And something that is important to me, in order to be able to stay within that my moral compass, my accountability framework, is to have financial freedom. And having financial freedom is actually being able to do what I want to, when I want to, within my accountability framework, and be on the straight and the narrow. And to be able to do that, there are certain fundamentals that are just important. Education, be it formal education, be it acquiring something on the street, but learning to do the right kind of thing that will get us to where we want to be. I was fortunate, I had the formal education. I went to school, I went to a couple of different universities in Nigeria. Been abroad, done a lot of training, but I'm happy to say that if you look at someone that is homegrown, I'm such a person. Yes, I have had the opportunity to travel around the world, different continents, and it also helped me in terms of building a social capital that is required in this day and age to be able to operate at a very competitive level. So when we have the opportunity to travel, we travel. I'm proud to say that I have been to 33 out of the 36 states in Nigeria, and I also live in Abuja, the federal capital, and county 19. I've been around the entire country. The best classrooms, the best opportunity to learn is out there when you meet people. Traveling not for the sake of saying that I've been to the United States 10 times, but no, what have I learned from that culture that I can come and use and adapt here to be able to do things right? And sometimes it's about what actually have I learned that I know is not the way that I want to be able to do things here. Some things are just for that purpose as well, not to actually come and do it in your own place. There are things that I wouldn't want to see adapted here, for example, the issue of sagging pants and stuff like that. There's just no culture that do it for us. So, and then of course, work, engage, have something to do that is productive, that you can contribute to your community, to your society. And I've done my share of that. I started out with paid employment in great organizations across the spectrum of the economy. I was with non-governmental, not-for-profit organizations. I worked with government and I also worked with corporates. But a certain time came in my life where I just said to myself, it is enough that I was too old to have a bus. But most importantly, I wanted to fulfill my dream of creating a platform where I could work with people that are my inspiration, that I wanted to impact positively to actually achieve what I want. And that is how the story of the business people started, the TBP for me. And it's basically an organization effectiveness company that works to help organizations that we work with, and these are some of our clients, put up systems, come up with strategies, policies, simple procedures, processes. And I'm proud to say that some of the most exciting things that we have done has been with SMEs. And if you look at the bulk of our country today, the highest percentage we have of about 75% are 35 and below. And these people, of course, are all trying to work on things that belong to them, take ownership, build their own and own their own capacity. But we also realize that there's their lack of understanding of actually how to set up simple organizations that have systems that are functional and that would be able to sustain itself. So we're very happy that we do this. We are a profit-oriented organization, but also and we are still small. We started in 2004, but we have inculcated one culture, a culture of giving back, a culture of volunteerism, a culture of understanding that there are people that don't have enough to do what they need to do, or that are people that society has marginalized, that are vulnerable groups that we work with. And we identify key among those group of people that we have to work with are the women. And it's very, very interesting what we try to do with women. We work a lot in terms of capacity, especially access to technology. How does the woman that is actually does not have access in terms of the fact that it's not of our own making, but it's just the culture that she happens to belong to. It could be a culture that is related to her religion or a culture from where the accident of birth happened. We have a great story of how we worked with a certain woman when we take them through such processes of working. We focus on what is your dream, where do you want to go to, and where do you want to achieve this. Our processes are highly participatory, where we work with them, and they actually just evolve because a lot of us have a fair understanding of what we're doing and what we want to do and how we want to do it. But it's to help with the crystallization, and we do this on a volunteer basis. One of such women that we've been working with since 2007, dates back to when I was still working with a corporate organization, is Hajia Halima. But she has evolved to be one of my favorite persons to support, and we're still working with her up till today. And from someone who actually has never touched a keyboard before, we had a lady this picture shows her standing on stage in Phoenix, Arizona, getting an award as a change agent, global change agent, impacting women. And what she'd done, using the technology knowledge that she acquired, she actually impacted over 10,000 people in her community in the northeast of Nigeria. And on their own, they carried out a study that showed that divorce rate actually reduced with about 42%. That was amazing. And why was that so? Because women were economically empowered to do little things, and the little things are very important that would change their life. And this, we find it very exciting. But so we have our tactical interventions, if you wish, the training and stuff like that. We also evolve to issues around supporting strategically, and that is where working with different organizations on a volunteer basis, especially both of not-for-profit, becomes very important in the work that we do. And I sit on the board of these organizations over time now. And one is able to help to say, okay, if we help strategically in terms of content creation, in terms of creating vision and plans for this organization, then you are able to reach a greater number of people. But also working with government in terms of supporting policy process and working on policies that addresses the constituency that one believes in. And that is why even the work that we have done on community radio and we're still doing comes in. It's about policy engagement. We were looking at how do we address last mile issue in terms of technology. Like we know, the numbers vary, but we have about 130 million mobile phones or handheld devices today in the country. How many really, when someone has a bag, a tote bag, and there are just five phones in it and they all belong to different networks. So when we look at last mile issues, how many people in terms of real number, but also access in terms of access to if you wish, broadband or bandwidth and stuff like that. And issues of affordability, issues of appropriateness of technology and understanding it. And we have been on this advocacy for the community broadcasting subsector to come up. Something that is still on, but perhaps we need young and fresh minds and blood to come in and give it more energy and bring a different perspective to what we need to do to get to where we need to get to. There are certain things that we have to do, put in place as a parameter if we want to get what we're doing right. Now, I'd like to ask, who discovered the River Niger? This is something we all learned in history, and we've talked about how history actually is not a very strong point that we focus on in this country. But I know that that is one thing that we all know, who discovered River Niger. Yes, thank you very much, Mungo Pap. Okay, clap for yourselves. But guess what? We're wrong. Some people lived there, and Mungo Pap was actually led there by some people. However, why do we have it in recorded history today that Mungo Pap discovered River Niger? For the simple reason that he documented it. So whatever media we have for documentation, we call ourselves orally oriented people, but there are devices to even do those record. We need to be able to record, but starting from even what we do as organization, we have to come up with ways of documenting our work for shared learning, for posterity, for even just getting better. That is something that we have to get right. And we have to actually learn to stand out in a very positive manner. We are notorious today for all the wrong reasons. Oh, you talk about Boko Haram is synonymous with Nigeria. You talk about all conquering is synonymous with Nigeria. We don't want to stick out for those reasons. We want to stick out for our creativity, our young people in the music industry and other art-related creativity industry are doing brilliantly well, and this is the kind of things that we want. But even as an individual, as an organization, or as a nation, we need to brand ourselves with positive things and be able to make it stick, because that is then how we succeed as a nation. Show gratitude. The simple thank you, the patting on the back to the person that put this thing together, but most importantly to the cleaners, to the person that ensured that the cables are running right. Let's just say thank you. That goes a long way to get us to continue to do things and do things the way we should do them. Of course, issues of change we cannot overemphasize. But most importantly, attitude. Attitude, the good attitude, the positive attitude gets us to where we want to. And I'd like to carry out a very small exercise. If we were to look at numbers and the alphabet, if we were to write A, B, C to Z, it gives us 26, right? So And if we are to look at some of the things that we consider as important in our life, let's look at spouse, for example, or love. If we add love, how much would it give us? Gives us 54, if we were to add it in number. Now, spouse. Spouse gives us what? It gives us 95. Fantastic. Knowledge. That is very important to the way we do things. Let's see how much will knowledge give us. Knowledge gives us 96. Fantastic. All these things are important to what we do, how we do what we do, and with what we do it. And if you look at this, you look at things that are sustainable. Knowledge is a key tool for sustainability. Spouse, look at it as a partnership. Love is empathy, but I always thought love was overrated anyway. And that's why you get average here. But let's look at what attitude gives us when we actually adopt attitude. If you were to add attitude in number, amazing, isn't it? It gives us 100%. It means that whatever we strive to do, whatever we do, we should strive to have the best of attitude. That is what will get us where we are. And there's this saying that goes that a bad attitude is like a flat tire. You're not going to go far if you don't change it. You're not actually going to go anywhere if you don't change it. So let's put that in the back of our mind as we're reviewing where we are and what we would like to be. Learn. That is the opportunity we have to be what we want to be. You cannot beat it with learning because you keep evolving. Alvin Toffler said, the illiterate of the 21st century is not the person that cannot read or write. It's the person that does not have the ability to learn, unlearn, and relearn. So the world is your field to learn. Let's go out and learn how to do the small things because they evolve into the big things. It gives us the opportunity to be able to be sustainable in what we do, to innovate and to change the world. And that's what we are at the point where we can take the leadership and change the world. We can do it. It's just to get the right ingredients in place and actually do those things to get where we want to be. Believe in yourself. Believing is a very, very strong aspect of what we all do. Believe in yourself, because if you don't believe in yourself, how do you create that island of sanity that we all need to have and to grow into the big nation that we want to be able to execute with excellence? And executing with excellence means that you are known for near perfection. Fantastic organization I've seen around here for the TEDx, but we got it from the TED event and we wanted to see the same thing implicated here. And the group that has done this has done a brilliant job. But let's look at small organizations, SMEs. Do you have a standard font? Are you a vagina person? Is the organization focused on Tahoma? Do you have an alignment? When you do spacing, is it 0.5? Do it such that when a paper from your organization is picked up or someone gets a message from your organization, they say, yes, that is the business people. It is from this group because we know that they execute with excellence. And reap your reward. Celebrate success. As a people, we're too harsh on ourselves. We should be, because then it points us in the right direction. But when the little things happen and the big things, let's celebrate success. We've done fantastically well handling Ebola case. Let's keep it sustainable, but let's also celebrate the fact that we got it right. But we need to get more such successes and continue to believe in ourselves. And in believing in ourselves, it is about you. If you don't do it, no one else will. So you have to get to a point where the nucleus, you have to find peace within yourself. And you find peace because you got to a point that this is what I want to do, and this is what I'm doing, and this is what meets the needs of the society. And because it meets the needs of the society, I have arrived at that point of nirvana. However, like Abraham Maslow said, you get to that self-actualization point in the hierarchy of needs, and you reinvest yourself, re-evolve, because you want to conquer some more. So let's always get to that point of bliss, because then we can re-evolve and do more and get things right. Whatever it is as we're doing, please, one thing we should never, ever do, in spite of challenges in spite of whatever it is that we find out. And ladies and gentlemen, let's never, ever give up. We're at that point where we cannot afford to give up. Never, ever give up. Thank you very much once again for having me, and have a good outing. God bless you all.